Hello and welcome to my talk about TypeScript. Actually, I called this a practical introduction to TypeScript because I want to show you most of the things directly in the editor so that you not only see the language but also like how it feels to develop with TypeScript. And if you want to download the slides that I'm not going to show you, you can find it with this link. Yeah, before I start, I'd like to know who of you is writing Java or C# code or another language that uses a statical typed language? Okay, I think it's almost all of you. That's what I expected. And who of you writes JavaScript? Some. And who likes JavaScript? Okay, almost nobody, yeah. And is anyone here who already uses TypeScript, maybe? Okay, and do you like TypeScript? Ah, okay. Okay, almost all of you, I think, are known to Java or some other statical type language. Some of you are known already to JavaScript. I'm not going to give you an introduction talk to JavaScript. It's only TypeScript. But I think you get, you get some interesting ideas. Me, I'm Nils. I'm coming from Hamburg in Germany. I used to program in Java for, I don't know, about 20 years, I think. And recently, 3 or 4 years ago, I switched to JavaScript, which was a little bit painful. But actually now I have fun programming in JavaScript and more fun using TypeScript, which I use for, I don't know, 2 years maybe. And mainly I write currently React applications. So if you have any problems or questions, you can contact me under this email address, or my Twitter handle is @NilsHartmann. Okay. So when I prepared my talk, I don't know, 1 week or 2 weeks ago, I found this quotation from Rod Johnson, who is the creator of the Spring Framework. You might know the Spring Framework. By the way, if you want to know more about the Spring Framework, I think Jürgen Höller, his companion, has also a talk today in the afternoon. And Rod Johnson, who is one of the co-creators of the Spring Framework, said, TypeScript is probably the most important language right now, which I think is an interesting sentence from a developer that comes from a Java world. TypeScript makes JavaScript twice as good, and that's a conservative estimate. The question is, of course, how good is JavaScript? If JavaScript is low, multiplied by twice, it's still not a good language. I don't know. And also, I'm not sure if it really makes JavaScript twice as good as JavaScript. I don't know. But I think the important thing is the last sentence, in terms of impact, TypeScript is the most important thing right now, possibly. And I think Rod Johnson knows what an impact is because he created Spring, and all of us, I think, know what Spring is. So I think if Rod Johnson talks about impact, I think he knows what an impact is. I think I just copied these sentences because I find it very interesting and it makes good advertising for TypeScript, whether they are correct or not. Yeah. Okay, before I switch to the editor, some TypeScript features at a glance or on one slide. The first thing is TypeScript is built by Microsoft, which is a little bit, I think it's, for me, it's kind of strange that I would use a tool from Microsoft, which actually is quite good, because I think most of us, or many of us, have not the best opinion on Microsoft, but TypeScript and Visual Studio Code that I will use to write the TypeScript code is very good. And TypeScript is a superset of JavaScript, so that means that every JavaScript code you write is, at least in theory, valid TypeScript code. But you can add things on top, like the type annotations, to make the code type safe. And there are some other things built into the language, like visibilities, like enums, but I don't think that are the important parts. The most important parts is the type annotations, so that we can have like a typed JavaScript. And the compiler compiles the TypeScript back into valid JavaScript code, like ECMAScript 3. I don't know if anyone uses that, but ECMAScript 5 or 6 are quite popular right now. So when you write TypeScript, you compile it back to regular JavaScript so that the browser can execute that. Okie dokie. Yeah, as I mentioned, I want to make most of the things in the IDE directly. I hope everything will work. Otherwise, we have a lot of fun, or at least me. Okay, let's start by the first example I prepared. This, by the way, if you can't read, if you have problems to see what I've on the screen, please raise your hands. And also, if you have questions, please show up at every time. So as I mentioned, this is Visual Studio Code. This is my IDE, my favorite IDE for writing TypeScript code. But if you're using, for example, IntelliJ, that has also very good TypeScript support. And and Visual Studio Code, by the way, is written in TypeScript, so it's it should work really well with TypeScript, and it actually does. So the first thing I want to show you is that you can use TypeScript actually without writing TypeScript code, but just by using JavaScript code. And therefore, I prepared a little demonstration. I created a function or some a function that is like a factory function, which creates an object that is composed of three parameters that I put into this function, name, age, and hobby. And the hobby is an optional parameter. And I add some JS documentation to this method. And I have another function, getAdultAge, that returns 18 as a string, why ever. And then we invoke this function. We call Hans, Susie, and Klaus. And on Klaus, we call some methods and do things. So everything fine. That is valid JavaScript code. If you would run this in a browser or in Node.js, it probably would work, but maybe not, because there might be some errors inside. And we can see that if we just enable TypeScript for this file using the tscheck directive. And you see immediately as I type this at tscheck, here's some errors. Interesting. OK, let's see. The first thing is, cannot find name. Did you mean none? No, in this case, I don't mean none, but I mean name. By the way, the suggestions from the error messages are mostly very good. In this case, it's not correct what TypeScript suggests, but in many cases, it's correct. So we change this to name, and now the function is error-free, hopefully. Now let's go further. Here we have a problem. Exactly. We use, we call a new person to create an object, and we see this object has the age parameter. But the problem is the object we create, we never return. So this function is void, and this type is void. It's nothing. So at runtime, that would fail because Hans would be undefined. So another thing that TypeScript helps us to detect. Return P, now that is fine. Next thing, here we have the error is that the first two parameters here, name and age, are required, are mandatory parameters. We cannot leave them out. But here, obviously, I have not set an age for Susie. Let's change that. Maybe she's 32. And now everything compiles. And I think these errors that we see here are typical errors that happen when you write JavaScript code. At least that are my typically errors. That's why I put them in here. So everything is fine. So next problem. I want to assign Klaus to a new age, to this adult age. But the problem here is, let's see, the type string is not assignable to type number. We have here, when we go to the definition of age, here, we set by setting this JSDoc header that age is a number. And TypeScript can now interfere. If this is a number, then this is a number. Then in the returned object, age is still a number, but getAdultAge returns a string, which is an error again. So let's fix that. So now we're returning a number. TypeScript assumes this function returns a number, which is correct. And now I can change this. So next thing, we have this hobby parameter here. And this is a little bit complicated to read, but this is valid JavaScript code. If this hobby parameter that might be set or might be not set, but if it is set, this object that we return also have a function called spend time with hobby. Actually, I don't know if it's correct English, but anyway. And if the hobby is not specified, then you can't spend time, and so the function is not set. So the returned object either contains this function or not, regarding if hobby is set or not. So, and in this case, hobby, let's see what TypeScript error message is possibly undefined, because we don't specify a hobby here, right? When we call a new person here, we don't specify a hobby. So the returned object does not contain this message, so I cannot be sure at this point here, when the code comes to this place, I cannot be sure that hobby is a function that I can call, or an object on which I can call. Sorry, I'm in this line. You know, I cannot invoke this function because this function might be might be undefined or not. That's what I said. So what we have to do is, for example, check if this property is there or not. I make it very simple now and comment it out. It's always a good idea because commented code that is commented out does not produce errors. Okay. So the same problem is for the hobby. The hobby is or may be optional, so it might be undefined. The returned object might contain the hobby parameter or not, the hobby property. And in this case, it's not sure if hobby is defined. And at runtime, we could get a problem. I think you all know this problem, this error, if you have ever run JavaScript code, like something is not a function or cannot invoke on undefined or something. And these kinds of errors TypeScript detects for us at compile time, at build time. So here I could, for example, do this one. And only if hobby is actually available, then I can call to lowercase. And TypeScript, by the way, also knows that this place, if it is actually set this property, then hobby must be a string. In this case, we see property hobby is a string. TypeScript actually sees that we checked here, hobby is string or undefined. Now we check if hobby is not undefined, then TypeScript knows it must be a string. And we only can call methods here that are defined on string. This is something we have in Java also. So maybe for Java programmers, at least this code completion is not that spectacular. But if you're writing JavaScript code, I think this is spectacular. Great. Okay, that's just a simple example. Yeah, here, parameters are missing. Okay, so now our JS file is valid JavaScript code. Maybe has no errors at runtime anymore. That's just a short introduction. Now let's go to TypeScript, actually. The first things I want to show are some basic syntax. As I mentioned, the whole TypeScript language is based on JavaScript, so we are writing JavaScript and adding things on top to our JavaScript code. And the first thing is, let's do this one. Let's declare a variable. That is valid JavaScript code. Let name equals Klaus is ECMAScript 6 code, no problem. And there is some problem in my setup here. Sorry. Export. Please ignore this line. You have never seen this. I scroll it out. So that's basically, this makes this whole file or everything in this file private. And So now I declare a variable with the value Klaus. And when I hover over this property, we see in this tooltip what kind of variable it is. It's a string. And that is one of the basic features of TypeScript, that TypeScript infers the type for us. We don't have to write down actually types, but TypeScript can infer the types for us. So TypeScript says, sees this is a string, then name must also be a string. If I now change name to like 7, I got an error that 7 is not assignable to string, which is of course not. So even even if I don't have I have not specified a type, TypeScript knows name is of type string. I could also say it, write down it explicitly with this double colon and then the type. This is the TypeScript syntax, and then it's explicit. And if I would change this to 7, then I would get here the error message. So this is very powerful. And by the way, this is why this TS check directive in the JavaScript code works, because TypeScript can infer types even without that you have written down some types. Okay, yeah, we have the basic JavaScript types built in, of course. We have strings, we have booleans, numbers, void, we have arrays and things. And we have a special type, which is called any. And any means that you can assign any value. That is something like the last exit. If nothing else works, you just write down any, and then you can do anything with this type. This should also this should always be the exception that you write any in your code. But there are some cases where you can't actually write down a correct type. Okay. By the way, if you define a variable of type any, then there's no further type checking done with this variable. So now I can specify name should be 7, name should be Klaus, name should be false. All this is valid now because TypeScript just stops checking the source the code. And there's an interesting thing that if TypeScript cannot infer a type for you, there are some places where it can't know what type a variable is of, then it implicitly assigns this any type. And that means, for example, when you have legacy code that is not built in JavaScript, that's not built in TypeScript, and you convert it to TypeScript by changing the file suffix to TypeScript, then TypeScript tries to infer the types for your variables, and wherever it cannot infer a type, it implicitly assigns this any type. So it generally, your code still works after migrating to TypeScript, and then you can walk through your code and make the types maybe better or maybe explicit. And there is a mode, and I've included the mode here, or I enabled the mode, that forbids TypeScript to set any implicitly. That is, if you're starting a new project from scratch using TypeScript, then you don't want to TypeScript, then you don't want that TypeScript assigns any to any of your types implicitly, because you want to think about what actually are my types, and you then want to explicitly assign these types to your variables. So there is an error message, I think is something like cannot assign any implicitly or something, and then you know TypeScript would assign any to these types because it can't infer something for the type, but you forbid it in your configuration, and then you have to go there and specify a type yourself. Okay, there's another feature you can enable, and also I've enabled this here, that is strict null checks. By default, you can assign null to any type, but I've enabled this feature that I cannot assign null to any type. Let's see how that works. Let's go back to this one. And now let's try remove the errors. Say name should be null now, which would, by the way, in Java, that would not be a problem. We can assign null to any type. But in TypeScript, type null is not assignable to type string. As I mentioned, you can enable or disable this feature. For new projects, I definitely would recommend to enable this feature. By the way, this would be something I would really like to see in Java too. Okay, and the same is true for undefined. I cannot assign, undefined is not assignable to type string. That undefined is a type in TypeScript, null is a type in TypeScript, string is a type in TypeScript, and if you have a variable of type string, the variable cannot be null because it's another type. What we can do is we can assign more than one type to a variable. That is strange, that's not possible in Java. We can say name should be string or null. And now, great. Now we can assign the null to the name. So if we are sure that this variable can be null, then we can say, okay, this actually can be null. But we have to think about that. And I think this would be a great feature for Java, I think. And by the way, the same is true for undefined. We can say string is null or undefined, and we can also say it's undefined. Or, of course, we could also say this could also be a number, and then can also be a number. And you can imagine you can write as many ors as you want. Exactly. This is a very important feature. We'll come back to this later. Okay. Exactly. Let's, by the way, one thing I want to show you. Let's go back to this one. Now, TypeScript knows name is a string. By the way, in Visual Studio Code, you can always go with the mouse over a variable, and in this pop-up, you see the type that TypeScript has inferred, or in this case, we have explicitly written. We see here, we have all these methods that are defined on string because TypeScript knows this is a string. Great, so, okay. If we now switch to this can also be null, okay. Then some, yeah, we get this message that this code might be null because, well, it can, in this case, it's actually null, but here it can, of at least it can be not null. So we have to check this. We have to check before if name not null or some other checks, however you do that. That's, TypeScript is too clever for me, I think. So now we have this null check or this not null check, and now TypeScript knows that in this block, name is never null, it's always a string. Okay, by the way, if I would add again this maybe not so clever way. This is some not so clever example code. Then here, TypeScript knows the type is not null, but it still can be a string or a number. And in this case, unfortunately, it knows that it's number because I've written here number. But if it was not so explicitly, you would see the error message that starts with is not defined on string or number or something, something similar. Okay. Remember, if you have questions, please raise your hands. Okay. I can write, of course, I can write functions in JavaScript and in TypeScript. And let's say get hobby. And I can say, I can write parameters. And behind the parameter, I can write the type. Let's remove the type here because now we have this error message I explained to you some minutes ago. Parameter name implicitly has an any type. At this point, TypeScript cannot know what type or what name should have for a type. It's not possible for the compiler to detect the type of name. So it would assign any to the type because it can't infer any type. But as I forbid TypeScript to assign any implicitly, I get this error message. So I have to think what name could be for a type. Let's say, oops, no. Let's say it's string. And then I have also, TypeScript knows this is a string. And the code I write is completely nonsense. It's just about the syntax and things. Please keep in mind. So now let's call get hobby. First error is, of course, we should provide the name argument. Of course, with a number, it does not work because a number is not a string. With null, it does not work because null is not a string. Let's pass in a string. Now it works because, yeah, name is a string. And TypeScript also now infers the return type of this value. You see here, function get hobby name string returns a string. So age also is of type string. So here I could remove or could be move back to uppercase, for example, which does not make any sense to code, but it's just about the syntax. So even if I have not specified the return type here, TypeScript infers return type for me. So I don't have to specify explicitly the return type. I can explicitly specify the return type, and I would do this maybe for all of your public API methods. For all other things, I don't think it's necessary, but for public API methods, it might make sense. So if I want to return a number, I get this error, string is not assignable to number, of course, and if I switch back to string, then it works. So this is explicitly written what TypeScript infers anyway when I remove this string. So this is, I think, that are really powerful concepts, especially if you have in mind that JavaScript is a really, really dynamic language. We have some other things I can show you. We have classes. And the classes, or when TypeScript defined classes, that was before ECMAScript 6, so before JavaScript. Now JavaScript also has classes, but the TypeScript classes appeared before JavaScript has classes, and they are almost identically, with the one exception that I have to, of course, specify parameters. For example, I want to create X with a parameter of type string. I have to write this here. And what I also can do is I can do private and define private and protected methods and properties, like say private name string, and this dot name is name. And if I say const x gleich new x, then I cannot access x not access name because name is private. That is very, very similar to Java, so I skip this part. There's also another thing called enums, but I think yeah, it's like an enum. Enum. TypeScript enum. I think, to be honest, I have used the enum feature exactly one time in my project for 2 hours and then I removed it because I've never need it. We just see in a minute another thing that we can use instead of an enum. I don't think, personally, I don't think enum is not the most important feature of TypeScript. So but what you can do is enum language, let's say JavaScript or TypeScript. And you will see that I'm not able to use this enum because I normally not use enums. Const L is language, and language JavaScript maybe. Not surprising if you're coming from Java, and this is also not surprising that that does not work so. By the way, most of the things that we are writing in JavaScript, in TypeScript, sorry, are removed by the compiler. All these type annotations are completely gone in the JavaScript file. We have no reflection API or something. It's plain JavaScript. I can just show you maybe. I cannot show you. One second, yarn watch. So now I compile my workspace to this dist folder, and we're here. And we see, okay, that is the our enum that we just written. I don't want to write this, that by hand. But let's see another example. Const L, it's some very basic example. We've seen this already. It's we define L as to be a string, and bam, here. TypeScript just removes this this information that is a string. So we can at runtime we have no chance to get this original type. And the same, by the way, is true also for the visibility in classes. If we have a private field at runtime, the field is public as it is normally in JavaScript. And that is an explicit design decision by Microsoft for TypeScript that the code should behave like should be the compiled code should be. Really, really JavaScript-like. Okay, questions so far? Okay. Now let's go to some other thing another example, which is a little bit more complicated. I want to talk to you about interfaces. When we're working with JavaScript, we have almost everywhere in our code, we just use objects like this. Person name, right? Many JavaScript code contains this kind of objects. We don't have to create classes or something, we just use objects. And in TypeScript, we can define the shape of these objects to make sure some object matches an expected patterns, expected pattern or an expected shape. And we can do this by using, by writing an interface. Please do not compare interface in TypeScript to JavaScript. It's a little bit, or it's different. For example, what we can do is we can, or in this example, I want to create some a factory function that creates a data source for us. I think it's a typical use case. Of course, I don't implement a data source or something. It's just about the syntax. And in my data source config that I want to pass in here, data source config should be data source config. I want to have, for example, a URL, database URL, whatever. And I can define that in my interface. And that's, for example, it's not possible in Java to define fields in interfaces. In TypeScript, it's possible. TypeScript. And I also want to make sure that this could be null. And in my, by the way, this is all the data source that we create. It's just an empty object, so it's just for demonstration purposes. Let's return a data source here. And if we want to, I want to implement this create data source function, and the data source function receives an object with the configuration for the data source. This is a very common pattern in JavaScript, that you have factory functions that receives objects with different configuration possibilities, because there's no such thing like overloading or something like we have in Java. So this is common pattern to use objects, and these objects can be more or less complicated and deal with several use cases. And our data source config is quite simple at the beginning. We start with an URL, and this can be a string or it can be null. Here, the same applies as I showed you just before. If I define here only string, then URL could never be null. But for some reason, this can be null in this case. So now, if I want to use something, data source config. TypeScript knows data source config has this shape with only with this URL parameter, and URL parameter is either a string or null. So this is like we have also in Java, and I can now do something with that. But the problem here is URL also could be null, so I have to check this before. If data source config is not null, then now again, TypeScript knows at this place URL is now a string or not. And I can do something with that. So we have this null safety in our code. And now there's some other thing. I want to write I want to add an authentication. And this authentication can be just a string. And in this case here, also data source config authentication to lowercase. Just do something with this string. And now we have a new requirement that the authentication should not only be a string, but also can be at runtime an object consisting of username, password. So we define our maybe complex authentication object or wherever. Let's define username, password, authentication, which consists of username string and password also string, right? So, and in this case, we want to say authentication can either be still be a string, but also it can be this username and password authentication. So the user of our factory function can either specify a string, or he or she must specify this object. And now I change this to can be string or this one. Now TypeScript has again a problem, because at this point authentication can be a string or our object on our object, or in case that is an object, we can of course not call this function, because that is only defined on a string. So what we have to do is we have to check here if it's the one or the other. There are some ways to do it. I do it this one. Authentication triple equals string. Again, we have to write the correct source code. And in this case, TypeScript knows now, in this place, we can be sure that we have a string. And we also can write, no. In this case, TypeScript knows now, in the second branch of this if-else thing. TypeScript knows authentication now must be this object that we have specified here, consisting of username and password. And we can just use password and do something with it. So, and by the way, this is called a type guard because in it's like a guard for types. Two types coming in and one comes through this guard. And we can write also, I mean, this is now a very simple type guard, but there can be more complex type guards. And in case you want to define your own type guard functions, you can also do this. You can write, for example, this code is too technical for me. I want to make more meaningful code. Then I could use this if is like is string authentication. And then pass in this thing. And then we write this function. It's a regular function. And this is, this has one parameter. Let's call it candidate. So that something comes into this function. And the function returns if this thing that comes into the function is actually a string or a simple authentication. So I write any here because we can put in any. And it returns is candidate string. Most probably the syntax is wrong. I know I have to look this up every time. I think the syntax is correct. I made another mistake. So now, let's see. String return candidate type of candidate triple equals string. So now, now I can use this like more meaningful function across my code. Wherever I have this decision between string and other authentication, I could use this function. And if the logic changes to determine or to differentiate between these two things, or maybe I have someday I have a third authentication, then I just rewrite the logic here. And wherever I use that in my code, it just works. So this is also something that is not possible in Java. And by the way, you don't have to use type of here. You can also use instance of, or there are some things. The important thing is that this function returns true if this actually is your expected type. And there's one thing, I don't demo that now, but TypeScript uses structural identity. And that means if you have two objects that are called differently, like person and animal, and both have only one property, name of type string, then these objects are structural identical. And for TypeScript, this then are the same types. That is different than in Java. If we have two classes in Java, both have the same fields or the same methods, but they are called differently, then we always have two different types. In TypeScript, that would be the same. It's just, okay. Let's go to the next one. Again, if you have a question, please raise your hands. Tagged unions is also a very important part. Maybe if you're dealing with JavaScript, you know, as I mentioned, we are working very, very often with not undefined, but unstructured objects, just objects. And in this case, we want to implement a fictional execute query function. And the idea of this query is that, for example, we have an API that that receives JSON objects. And these JSON objects can be queries, like a delete query, insert query, select query. If that is a good thing for a REST API, I don't know. But for this example, it's a good idea. And in this execute query, I want to see what query have I received from my from a client, and then I want to execute specific logic. In Java, we most probably would do inheritance or something like that. We maybe have an abstract query or an query interface, and then we implement different strategies and things. But in TypeScript, we don't need this. And normally, you wouldn't do this, especially not if you receive your objects from a JSON endpoint. Okay, so this, we have these three queries. I already defined them. We have a delete query, we have insert query, we have select query. And as you see, every query here has some other property that we have to work with. And the first thing, this function should receive a parameter with the actual query that we received from our client, I don't know. And this should be of type delete query or insert query or select query. As I mentioned, if you're coming from an object-oriented world, this is maybe strange. But in JavaScript, this is the way it works often. And exactly. This function receives either delete, insert, or select query. We can define an alias for this. We can, in TypeScript, we can define type aliases. I can say type query is this one or this one or this one, and the query is our query. And by the way, this type queries, you can do it for everything. For example, type primary key. Oops. Should be string, for example, or should be string or null. So you can this is like an alias for another type. Okay, our execute function should now check what type of query it receives, and then it should do this query specific logic. And to make this, we add a type or a concept in TypeScript that is called tagged unions. And to differentiate these objects, we add another field, a string field, that I call now query type. And in this case, it should be delete. And in this case, it should be insert. And in this case, you guess it, should be select. Okay. So now the object that we would receive, for example, for a select query would look like this, const s select query. Query type must be of type select. And condition select all from blah. And as we heard in the previous talk about web security, we would never do this in real life, but here in our cinema, we do this. Okay. Okay, now back to our method. We have to now to define what actually query we have here. We can do this with switch query. And now if I use the code completion, TypeScript only shows me first query type, because the query type property is the only property that all these three types have in common. And it also shows me what value it can be. So let's say query type. I think I have to hurry up a little bit. In this case, TypeScript knows query type is a string that can only be one of these three values. Start with delete. Now TypeScript knows in this branch, this must be of type of a delete query, and we only can access the primary key, because in our delete key, we use primary key here only. So I just write the most worst code I've ever written. Insert query values, and the last one is select, and we return query dot condition. So of course this does not make any sense, but from a type perspective it makes sense. We have now type safe branches here based on the string we defined. We don't have to define a new class or something. We just define objects with a shape. And the interesting thing is now at this point, what is query? What type has query at this point? We have all cases covered in the switch statement, delete, insert, select. And query now has the type never, because it can never be, the code never reaches this line. I think never is my favorite type. And what we can do is now we can write some assertion function. Function assert something. And we want to receive an object that is of type never, which is strange, but it's. And when we receive, when our code comes into this method, we just throw an exception. Error. Invalid query. Exception. It's error, of course. Sorry. So we receive an object from somewhere that has either one this structure or maybe not, because someone sends us, like, for example, an update query, but we don't support this. Then at runtime, the code would come to this place. And then we can assert something, put in the query. Maybe assert something is a bad name. Assert, I don't know, unknown query or something. At runtime, someone sends us an update query. We don't support this, so the error is thrown and our code fails at this place because we cannot handle this. Maybe here's some better error handling, but in our case, it's, yeah. It's just this one. And the interesting thing is now, if I would add, for example, an update query, and that is, I think, the last thing I can show you today. Query type update. Let's say param string, I don't know. Maybe should make the correct syntax. And our query now can also be an update query. We receive an error here because the type now here is not never anymore, because the only type that it can now be is the update query. And immediately we get a compile error that we have to maybe have to add here some handling for our new update query. So this is a very useful concept, I think, because if you have this kind of objects where you have multiple or different shapes for or different types, the compiler tells you that you have not covered all cases here. The same would be true if I remove the update query maybe, and for some reason I just comment out this insert, then query here is insert query because it's the only thing that is left in this switch statement, and it's not never anymore. But this function here expects the never type, which is now not the case. So we get a compiler error. I think this is a very good feature. And by the way, very good feature. I think my talk is until 10 to 12. Is that correct? Okay. 2 minutes. Very, very quick. There's some concept in TypeScript that is called mapped types. A map types map one type to another, something that is not available in Java. Exactly. For example, we have here this interface person consists of three properties, and I have written some function patch person that should send a patch request to our JSON API. And by the way, as you see here, TypeScript also supports async await. And a patch in REST endpoints normally means that you don't send the complete object, but only parts of the object that you want to change. So if I call patch person with the whole clause here, which is a person, everything is fine. But let's say I only want to change the name. Then a clause is not a person anymore, of course, but let's remove this. And then we get the compiler error here because this one is not a person here. What I want to specify is that I want to, that this types is not, that this type person here is not the whole person, but a subset of person. And we can actually do this in TypeScript. I can write partial, and this is a generic, partial person. And then I can, then this type of person is a subset of my original person type. I can specify all properties now. If I specify a property, it has to be the correct type, so I cannot change name to number, for example. And there's another problem here, maybe in this function. I could, for example, check if p name, so if name is set, or I don't have to check this, by the way. I can just say name, ha, ha, ha. So I can overwrite the original object I received, which is also maybe not that what I want to do in this function. Well, I want to make sure that the object I receive is not changed in this function. I can use another generic, and this is called read-only. And I can chain this together. And now TypeScript knows this type, the type receive is partial and it's read-only, so I cannot change the properties on the type. And now it's 11 after 12, so I think it's lunchtime. Thank you very much. And if you have questions, you can ask me now, or you can come, or yeah, wherever. I wish you a nice day.